with us? Let's stand and praise the Lord together.
Greater is the one who's in us. Greater is the one who calls our name. He will never fail.
Grave. He overcame everything that could be burdening us. He did. Even to the point of healing us and redeeming us. Isn't that great? What?
Awesome.
Yes, it's awesome. It's awesome. Let's give an applause to the Lord and let's sing that He's our healer today.
Jesus, you're all I need.
altars are open if you would like to come and pray. You can remain seated and pray in your seat as well if you would like. But let's join together in prayer this morning.
Let's pray this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come before you today, and we always seem to think about our prayers and maybe the ways that we worship in, a lot of us here recognize that you're all that we need and you're enough for each and every one of us, but sometimes we have doubt and sometimes we don't actually recognize that, and we don't have, our faith isn't strong enough, dear Father. So I just ask that you would be with us today and that we would have the faith that nothing is impossible, and that these prayers that we do lift up to you on a daily basis, that you do hear them and you do care and you do want to answer those, dear Father. Because a lot of times we just say the words and we just let them go, but deep in our hearts we don't really think that they're going to be answered. So dear Heavenly Father, today in our prayers we lift them up with confidence, and we recognize who you are and how much that you love us and that you care for the things that we care about. So dear Heavenly Father, I lift up those ones who are struggling today, or maybe looking for a job, or maybe dealing with that disease, that you would make a way, dear Father, that you would have an answer for us, that you would strengthen our faith. And dear Father, we give you praise for the ways that you work and the ways that we do see you at, around us, and the way that you do answer our prayers, dear Father. And dear Father, we pray for our service today and what you have for each and every one of us, and the way that we can just grow and think about things in a different way and learn more about you, dear Father. May our hearts and minds be open to what you have. We pray for Pastor Morgan as she brings us the message this morning. May you be with each and every one of us. And in Jesus' name this morning, amen. Good morning. I want to welcome you to our service today. I'm glad everybody's here. I see some people have some green on. Not everybody, but we might be too old for that. Jeff's going to come forward and pass out a black booklet, and we just ask that you sign it and kind of set it down on the chair beside you. And as he comes this morning, let's go ahead and pray for our offerings also. Dear Jesus, we once again thank you for the ways that you take care of us. May we be good stewards. May we be generous. May we be faithful to what you've given us. And dear Father, may we rely on you because you love each and every one of us. We just lift these things up in your name. Amen. I want to remind you that you can always give online here at the church. And so that's an opportunity that you have throughout the week. Also, our sharpening the focus. So our first week, we had about 35 people. Last week, we had about 50. So I want to invite every one of you to come and be part of that tonight. It's 45 minutes of prayer, 45 minutes of discussion about the future of our church. It is a great time to be together as a church. Everyone here is invited, no matter what your age is, and it's a great time for us. Join us Monday night for, it says, a craft night for Easter centerpieces on March 18th at 6:30. So for those of you who are that do crafts, and that's not me, but I want to invite everyone here that wants to be part of that. Also, the Easter scramble is coming up, and Pastor Mickey's looking for used egg cartons, so that she can do that, and also candy and small prizes. So if you would give that to her, she's looking for those things. The youth group is going to be doing a fundraiser for their trip to NYC this summer. It's called Once Upon a Murder, and it's going to be a murder mystery dinner, and it's going to cost $10. It's going to be on April 6th, so mark that in your calendar. The last one that they did was really fun and a great time to be together, and you'll be sitting at tables and go through the story. It's a really great time, so check out Pastor Morgan or the teens for that. It'll be awesome to be part of that. So today, you should have got a little pebble today for Morgan's sermon, and What we didn't tell you is if you don't agree with what she says, you start chucking it at her. Just throw.
That's why they're Thanks, Scott. Good morning. How are you? Good. Wow, there's already a pebble being thrown. So, like Scott said, my name is Morgan. I am the youth pastor here, and I'll be bringing our message today, but I just wanted to welcome you and say I'm glad you're here. To get started, if you weren't here last week, we introduced that we're in the middle of a new series called Dying to Live, and it's a series we're doing to prepare for Easter. So kind of like how Advent, we prepare our hearts and our minds for the coming of Christ's birth. Lent and this season that we're in is to prepare our hearts and our minds for Christ's death and resurrection. So today, before we go any farther, we're going to start with a game because we're going to be talking a lot about rocks today. And you have a rock, so there's going to be a common theme. But before we go farther, what we're going to do is you'll have about 30 seconds to write down what comes to mind for you when I say the word rock. This could be famous people, landmarks, places, things. Think of Family Feud, how there are certain things that people would generally think of when we say something. So there are 10 correct answers that you can get points for, and there will be a winner. But starting right now, you get 30 seconds to write down the five things, most common things in our culture, that come to mind with the word rock. On your marks, get set, go. All right, you have 10 more seconds to get five culturally relevant things associated with the word rock. And time's up. Pencils down or phones down. Okay, you will get points according to how common it is either on Google or the group of people that I polled, which is small and probably not accurate, but it's the best I had to prepare. So, first place for 18 points, if you had Dwayne "The Rock" Johnson, you get 18 points. For 16 points, the second most common cultural thing is a diamond ring. We call that a rock. Third, for 15 points, rock and roll. Fourth, the Rocky Mountains. Fifth, for 10 points, Peter. His name means rock. So actually give yourself 15 points if you got Peter because you knew what his name meant. Next up, if you're outdoorsy, you might have put Red Rock. That's a national park, I think, or a state park. It's really cool either way. Next up, School of Rock is 7 points. And then Kid Rock is 6 points. Rocky Balboa should be more points, but it's 5 points. And last but not least, Stonehenge. Did anybody have any of those? Oh, good. Okay. Stand up if you had more than 5 points. We have to figure out who the winner is. Okay. Stand up if you had more than 10 points. Okay, stay up if you had more than 15 points. 20 points. Okay, 21. 22. 23. 24. 25. Do I need to go higher? 30. Hey, Dave Conrad is our winner today for Rachel. So round of applause for the Conrads who might have worked together, but they won first place. So today, if you haven't noticed, we'll be talking about rocks. We're not talking about Dwayne "The Rock" Johnson, Rocky Balboa, or the Rocky Mountains, but we are talking about Peter and some of the things that he has to say. So to give you background before we read our scripture, we're reading from 1 Peter, which is a letter that Peter wrote. And again, Peter's name means rock. That's literally what it translates to. And he writes this letter where he references rocks and stones a whole bunch of times. But basically, for Peter, all you need to know is that he was called from being a fisherman to follow Christ. Jesus changed his name from Simon to Peter when he began following him. Peter is kind of that person that you probably know people like this, who he's not a thinker, but he's the doer. So he doesn't really like hesitate and pause. He just jumps into responding or acting or doing. That's Peter. He's also relatable because we see him succeed and fail throughout Scripture, to the point where he was the one known to deny Christ three times before Christ died and resurrected. But then, after Christ resurrected, was reinstated when Jesus said, "Do you love me?" three times, and Peter said yes three times, then went on to be a core leader of the early church. So that's our narrator for today. But as we read, your goal is every time you hear the word stone or rock or anything that relates to a stone or a rock, raise your hand. I think we did this a couple weeks ago with something Mark read, but we're going to do that again today. So we'll go ahead and get started. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture, it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a precious and chosen cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame." Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become a cornerstone, and that stone causes people to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also that they were destined for. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wondrous light. So this is a big section. We're only going to be working out of two main verses from that, but they work within the context of that whole passage. So I wanted to read the whole passage. But as a whole, what on earth does that mean? I was talking to my sister about this, and I said, "Okay, Haley, like, the call to action is to be like a rock." And she was like, "What does that even mean? Like, that makes it more confusing than easy." Like, for us, when we do an object lesson, we do something that's quick and easy to understand and relatable. Like, if I brought a candle up, I would say, "Okay, we're called to be a light in the world, like this candle, how it lights up the darkness." Like, the transition is easy to see. So when Peter gives us this passage and pretty much says, "Be a living rock," does anybody understand what that means from the get-go? Probably not. It's confusing at first glance. But we're going to talk about what that means. And we're going to talk about it both internally and externally, what Peter means when he says to be a rock. He describes it in a couple ways. And for us, we're going to be talking about our call to live into this idea of being a living rock in regards to our name. So again, we're in a series called Dying to Live. Today's message is dying to our name. Now, in biblical times, Old Testament and New Testament, there are many people who they literally had a name change. They wrestled with God and came out with a new name, followed Jesus, got a new name. That was like the business that God was in, was changing people's names. Whereas now, if somebody walked into our church and said, "Hey guys, I talked to God, he said my new name is Brittany," then we'd be like, "Okay, Brittany, sure." That doesn't happen. Like, that's not common today. But for us, when we think of a name, oftentimes what comes to mind is our reputation or identity. Like a little kid, when you say their name, they puff up with pride and they say, "Yeah, that's me. I'm Morgan." It also means glory and praise. Like at a sporting event, if you go, I have no idea who LeBron is playing for now, but if you go to a game where he's playing, you'll hear his name yelled. They're yelling his praise. They're kind of glorifying LeBron. So we're going to talk about name in that regard, as far as reputation, glory, identity. But first, we're going to talk about reputation. We're going to talk about dying to our reputation. But to die to something, we have to know first what it is. So we're going to do a little bit of kind of stepping back and examining ourselves to look at, what is our reputation? How do I view myself? How do other people view me? What are the things that feel true about who I am? For example, I want you to try and write down or think of as best you can what you would describe your reputation as. But here are some examples of things you might put. There are positive things like successful, hardworking, a servant or a helper, likable, put together, or dependable. But then there are also negative things like a failure, misunderstood, the pessimist, the one-upper, the gossip, the bad friend or the bad parent, or even the dumb one. Before we go farther, I want you to take maybe 15, 20 more seconds, not too long, And I want you to try and write down on your phone or your little bulletin or just think of, how would you describe your reputation? Both how you view yourself as well as how other people view you. The good and the bad. What all would that include? All right, go ahead and wrap up your reputation. You can keep going if you need to put more. But with our reputation, I think a lot of us, we guard and protect and care deeply about our reputation, what we think of ourselves, what other people think of ourselves. And let's just say to get started that our reputation is to be a rock. You each have one of those. We each have a reputation. We each have a rock today. And for fun, I'll show you something I tried to do. I brought up the little pebbles with me, but then I thought that that probably wouldn't be as impactful from on stage, so I went out to our church garden. Thank you, Lynn, for putting big rocks in our garden. But a lot of us have reputations, good and bad. Right now, a lot of us have these rocks. Now, Christ calls us to die to our reputation. In Peter's letter, he writes down that this living stone that we're called to be is described in two ways, as rejected by humans, and as chosen by God and precious to God. Now, what's interesting is those work together. So with our rocks, a lot of us, what I notice I think we do, is we have this reputation, this thing that people see us as, and we try hard to make it look presentable or good or put together. We have this front that we put on, but it's not truly who we are. See, Christ calls us to let go of what the world thinks of us. To let go of the opinions of others, the successes we rely on, the failures that we have from the past, even the ways we view ourselves, in order to know how God truly sees us and views us. Now, the struggle is, I also have, these are supposed to be diamonds, but I could not buy a bag of diamonds this big that are real, so these are symbolic and hopefully still kind of represent something shiny and like a diamond. What a lot of us, I think, do when we think of dying to our reputation is we take our rock and we try and clean it up and we wash it and we make it look as good and as presentable as possible. But tell me, no matter how hard you scrub and clean and even paint rocks, because that's a thing now, will this rock ever look like this? It won't. That's what we try and do is we think, okay, I can leave behind my reputation. I can change by cleaning this up, by making it look better, seem better, appear better, but it's still going to be a rock. Now, I'm comparing these two, and I'm going to just leave them right up here, because this rock that's rejected by humans is a rock that's chosen by God and precious to God. This is where the diamonds come in, is I think diamonds are something culturally that we understand as a precious rock. When Peter was writing down that we are this rock and this stone that is precious and chosen and valuable to God, I kept thinking, we walk on rocks. We put them in our driveway. They are not something that's precious and valuable to us unless it's something like a gem or a diamond. It's still a rock, but it's very valuable. It's precious. It's special. Now, again, what Peter's saying to try and use an object to communicate it is he's saying we have to be willing to let go of our reputation, be rejected, reject what the world thinks of us in order to become precious and chosen by God. Now, God chose us before we could ever choose him back, so it's not that he's waiting to choose us, but we experience the fullness of being chosen by him and the fullness of being precious to him when we begin to let go of what the world thinks of us to take hold of how God views us. For some of us, we have very positive reputations. We like to maintain that positive reputation. And even the idea of doing something to hurt or mar our reputation might, like, freak us out. For me, it does. If I have the thought of, like, messing up, for example, my recurring nightmare is showing up on stage but with nothing to say. And I think that's my recurring nightmare because it's in front of everybody. It would take my reputation from here down to here if I showed up completely unprepared. And I think a lot of us, in some way or another, if we care about what people think or not, we still want to have this good reputation, But yet Peter writes, we are rejected by men. We aren't chosen, we aren't loved, we aren't wanted. But Christ, who was rejected by men, we also are called to be rejected by men. And when we do so, we can experience being fully known and accepted and loved by God. So in other words, when we're willing to leave behind what the world says, good or bad, we begin to hear more of what God says. Some of us have negative reputations. We have failures that seem to haunt us. We have these ideas that people kind of know about us, and we have these things that we wish weren't there. Well, the best news is that we're called to die to that too. That means that when we follow Christ, we die to our failures, our past, the negative, the hurt, the sin, the ways we mess up. And God doesn't see that in us anymore. He sees us as precious and chosen and valuable. So whether good or bad, whatever our reputation, we are called to die to that, to let go of it, that we may be more intimately and deeply known by the one who created us with the longing to be known. Now going further, there's also our name in terms of glory. Again, like LeBron being at the basketball game, people yell his name, they kind of praise him. And I think, again, within each of us, there's a part of us that wants that. We want to be known, we want to be recognized, and we even want to be maybe glorified a little bit or have something that we are known for. I don't know if anybody else has done this, but I find myself, when I meet someone for the first time, in my head, as I'm talking to them, and in the middle of the conversation, I'm thinking, okay, how am I coming across? Are they ever going to want to talk to me again? Do they think I'm normal? Like, was this a positive thing? Is it negative? So I don't know if anybody else does that, but like mid-conversation, I know I am talking to someone with the intention of, okay, how am I coming across? How do they perceive me? What am I like to them? And I think we tend to do that as people. Now, Peter kind of goes on to say that being this living stone means living a life that praises God. He actually says in his letter, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. In other words, we each have this temptation and this desire to be known, to be glorified, to have our name mean something, so that even when we die, people will remember us. And at our funeral, they'll say great things, and they'll say, wow, this person, they accomplished so much with their life, or they were the best parent, or they were the best fill in the blank. We want to be known and remembered, but again, like the diamond that we are called to be, what's beautiful about a diamond? Can anybody tell me that? Did someone say it's shiny? Yes, that's correct. It's shiny, but it doesn't produce its own light. Diamonds, I meant to wear like earrings that were shiny, and I chose the worst ones today, but diamonds don't produce light. They don't change their essence in order to shine. All they do is they reflect the light that's already there. And Peter says, essentially, when you reject, you know, being worried and so caught up with what the world thinks, with what our family thinks, our friends think, all of that, and you accept that what God thinks and focus on that and that alone, you live into this idea of being this precious and chosen stone, but also, like a diamond, we are called to reflect the wonderful light, the light which is the true light, which is Jesus Christ. So with our lives, we are meant to be reflectors of the light, not a flashlight that makes its own light, not even a campfire, but just reflectors of the light that's already there. With a lot of us, I don't know how many of us do this too, but for me, I forget that when I go through my day-to-day conversations. Again, in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, okay, how am I coming across? How am I known? What do they think of me? Instead of approaching conversations and my work and every day-to-day part of my life with the thought in the back of my head, okay, how is Christ being seen in me? Did they see Jesus in me when I talked to them? Does my work resemble Christ? Does my family see Christ in me? Am I reflecting the love that God has given me? Am I forgiving others? Am I loving others? Am I kind to others? Will they notice that I'm different because of the way I live my life? Because if you look a rock versus a diamond, you'll see the difference. It's not hard to do. Now, to go one step deeper, I think a lot of us act the way we do. We seek glory, we seek praise, and want to be known based on deeper motivations. And I probably should have warned you from the beginning, this is like the opposite of a practical sermon. So like the practical ones are nice because you walk away with an action to do. This one is totally inward, heart-based. There's not going to be one clear action. But what I want you to do is step back and look at deeper things in your life and in your heart. One of those things is how we are motivated. I think a lot of us do what we do. We seek to be known based on what motivates us. And we'll tie this back together here in a second. But first, I want to know, what are the things that are motivating to us? I have a list that, does anybody know what Enneagram is? Okay, it's another personality thing that tells you more about what your personality is like. But it's built a lot off of motivations and the deeper things that drive us to do what we do and act how we act. Well, anyway, there's this list of 9 things based on different personalities that are motivating to different people. So as I read through these, we're going to go ahead and raise your hand if you relate with something. So we'll get to know each other a little bit. And you can relate to multiple things. I'll probably raise my hand on multiple things. But if there's something that you'd say, yes, that motivates me, yes, that deeply drives a lot of my actions and choices, I want you to raise your hand. This is going to be a very quick and short and sweet life reflection. The first one is getting things right and improving yourself. If you are driven by trying to get it right and better yourself, this would be one to raise your hand on. Next is being and appearing successful. I'll raise my hand for that 100%. Next is knowing, understanding, and being self-sufficient. Well, next is being happy, having fun, and contributing to the world. And then knowing, understanding, and being self-sufficient. So I relate with happy. I don't know if anybody else does. Next is keeping the peace and relating to others. If you're driven by wanting to keep your relationships harmonious and know people, that's one to raise your hand on. Next is being appreciated and feeling important to others. These are the people who, when you say, what do you want to do with your life? They say, I want to just matter to someone. I want to be a good parent. I want to be a good spouse. I want to help. I want to support. That's those people. Next is being unique and special. In other words, you are driven to find what's unique about you, to stand out, to live into that difference and that creativity. Next is being certain. Some people are driven by having certainty, having stability, knowing, and kind of being in that consistency. And last, being self-sufficient and strong and impacting the world. So these are people who they want to be seen as leaders, the ones who are making a difference. They can stand on their own, and they are impacting the world. Now, there might be other things that weren't listed here, but like I said, we each have different things that motivate us, that drive our actions. And I wanted to talk about deeper motivating factors, because for a lot of us, I think, you know, we have these natural things that motivate us, but then we also have Christ calling us to himself and saying, make me known. Know me and make me known. And the more we know Christ, the more Christ himself is our key motivator. And he gives us the desire to love people. He gives us the desire to want him more, the more we know him. But as a quick example, they don't always get along. Sometimes we have these natural motivating things in life that don't quite agree with Christ being known and being our motivating factor. For example, I'll give you one that I can speak to easily. I'm a peacekeeper. I like things to be harmonious and peaceful and well. So that means if there's a time and a place in life where as I'm talking with the Lord, he calls me to confront somebody, that is like my worst nightmare, because I have this motivation where I want to like love people, know people, care about people, but also be at peace with people. And to me, this natural motivation to keep the peace does not work well with confrontation and speaking harsh truth. But again, if my focus is making Christ known and being obedient to him, I have to be willing to let that motivation take second place or take the back seat compared to Christ motivating me and obedience to follow him motivating me. Does that make sense so far? Okay, I do that with the teens sometimes, and sometimes it carries over to Sunday mornings with me to double check. But in closing, I want to have time for a response. So we're going to go through the closing pretty quickly. But when we talk about being invited to die to our names, in my mind, it's basically those two simple things: dying to our reputation, which basically just means dying to what we think, what others think, and that mattering. That's the key there, is it's totally fine to have a good reputation. Or it's fine to have a bad reputation. What matters is that that isn't the most important thing and what motivates us. So dying to our name to follow Christ means dying to what the world thinks of us and what we think of us in order to give first place to what God thinks of us. It also means not trying to be known for ourselves and not trying to make our name known more through our work, our families, our relationships, and our actions, but rather making God known, making Christ known, the true light of the world and the one whom we are to reflect. So those are our invitations. And the beautiful thing is, so with every call to die, there's an invitation to live. So as we are called to die to our name, the beautiful part that we get to see is being known more deeply and more intimately by God than we have before. If we are willing to let go of what the world thinks and let go of what we think, good or bad, we can begin to hear that still small voice that says, "You are my beloved and you are precious and I want you and I chose you and I died for you." But we have to let go of other things to hear the voice of the one that matters most. In the same way, when we die to being glorified, when we die to wanting our names to be known, the beautiful life we get to see is Christ being known and him doing his work in the world. Because if we make him known, he's going to do awesome, awesome things with it. That is the good news. There's a call to die, but there's also the invitation to see life fuller and better than we could without dying first. So Tina, if you want to go ahead and pull up that song, I'm going to read through these questions that I want you to think about. And in a second, I'll just put these out on the altar. And I'm going to give you the chance. If you feel like you need to get up and actively put your stone on the altar as a symbol of dying to your name, I would invite you to do that. And if you want to take one of these home with you, you can, or you can look at it. It's up to you. I have 160, which should be enough for both services. But these will be on the altar. So with the song playing, we'll just have like a minute to reflect. Come up as an action if you want to die to your name and be intentional about that. And take one of these with you if this is more what you want to model, is knowing Christ and making Christ known. So go ahead, reflect, come forward if you would like. I'll go down and put these down there.
He knows my name. Yes, he knows my name. He knows my name. Yes, he knows my name. And oh, how he walks with me. Yes, oh, with me, yeah, and oh, how he tells me that I am his own.
You know my name,
dismissed. God, I thank you so much for who you are. I thank you that you take our reputations, good and bad, and you take all of who we are, good and bad, and you say that we are yours, and that we are precious, and that we are chosen by you. God, I pray that we would have the ability and the courage and the boldness to let go of what the world thinks of us, what other people think of us, and what we think of ourselves, in order to take hold of what you think of us, God. I pray that we could know you more, and that we could experience more of who you are, and that we could live by the truth of who you say we are, not by what the world says. And Lord, I pray that you would use us to make yourself known, that you'd be glorified through our lives, and that people could see who Jesus Christ is because of us and through us. Lord, I pray that you would have your way, and I pray that you would help move the things in our hearts that motivate us, that move us, that cause us to do what we do. Lord, I pray that you would continue to make us new, that you would help us to follow you by dying to our name so that we may live in your name. God, I love you so much, and I thank you for how good you are to us and how loving you are to us. I pray that you are with us throughout this week, that you continue your work in our lives and in our hearts, and that you do whatever you want with us. We love you and we thank you, God. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you are dismissed.